Okay, so what we are starting today is chapter 10, which is capital budgeting. How many people know what capital budgeting means? Anybody, have you heard the term before? Okay, so let me just give you a basic sense of what capital budgeting means. So large companies have money. So earlier we talked about cost of capital. So now a company has raised capital through, say, equity or through debt. What must it do with the money? It should spend the money on projects, which is investing the money. Okay. Now, how should a company decide what projects to invest in? That whole process of figuring out what projects to do, what projects not to do, and then if there are multiple projects, how to decide what to do first, what to do second. So that whole process is capital budgeting. So this little picture over here, effectively the decision of whether or not to build this plant is a capital budgeting decision. Okay, so in the context of capital budgeting, some basic terminology. What does capital mean? Operating assets used in production. So what did capital mean in the last reading that we did? So that was financial capital. What's the link between financial capital and this capital? Yeah, exactly. So the financial capital that we raise is going to be used to buy physical capital, such as operating assets. What do you think operating assets means? Yeah, the assets that are used in the regular operation of a business. So just as an example, the plant and equipment used by a given factory, is that operating capital? That is. What if a company makes shoes but on the side has a investment in land somewhere else, and on that land it maybe builds a warehouse and rents that out and generates rental income? So that would not be a operating capital, because that can be viewed as a separate investment. Okay, under IFRS there is separate accounting that companies need to do for investment oriented property. Okay, so that's investment. What we are talking about here generally is going to be operating assets. What's a budget? It's simply a plan that details projected cash flows during some period. When we talk about capital budgeting, it's the process of analyzing projects and deciding which ones to include in the capital budget. So essentially, what projects should we do, what projects should we not do, the whole analysis that goes behind that decision, and then the decision itself is your capital budgeting process. Okay, the criteria. So most of this chapter is about the criteria that companies use to decide what projects to go forward with and what projects not to execute. Okay. Now, why is capital budgeting important? It defines the firm's strategic direction. Why do you think that's the case? Exactly. So, what projects you do define your direction. So, for example, if a company that is based in Pakistan sets up a factory in Central Asia, that is saying something about the strategic direction that this company is expanding in Central Asia, for example. Or if a company that makes shoes now also starts making leather belts, that's also an example of showing what the strategic direction is. Results continue for many years, reducing flexibility. Okay, so in capital budgeting decisions, the decision that you make is actually going to impact you for a long term. So a friend of mine worked for an asset management company, and then from there went on to work for Engro. Okay, now the big difference between the two was, in the asset management company, most of the actions were transactional. Okay, but at Engro, the decisions that are made, whether or not to upgrade a plant, whether or not to set up a new processing unit, those decisions require a lot more time and effort. Why? Yeah, because once you make that decision, you have to live with that decision for a while. Okay, once you make a plant, you can't decide next year that I don't like this plant, it's not working out. Okay, that will be huge. Among other things, the person will lose his job. All right, so in capital budgeting, the decision that you make will have an impact over many, many years. Hence, it becomes extremely important to do your best to make the right decision up front. It involves large expenditures, typically, and a wrong decision can have serious consequences, such as you can get fired. Okay, all right, so the consequences can be pretty major. Okay, now what are the different kinds of projects? All this is warming up, so this is relatively simple stuff. So we are on the early stage of the treadmill. Pretty soon we'll start going uphill. Okay, so you can have replacement projects where you are basically doing the maintenance of a business. You are running a machine. The machine needs routine maintenance, else it will lose value and stop functioning properly. Do you think you do a tremendous amount of analysis to figure out whether you should sort of change the oil of your car every 4,000 miles? No, you don't do a whole long exercise. On the other hand, just as if your car now is a little old, so the maintenance cost is going up. Okay, do you think you might do an analysis before buying a new car? Yeah, that would be a replacement project. Okay, with a replacement project, you are trying to make an analysis that, look, my old car is costing me a lot of money. The maintenance cost is going up. I can buy a new car. What is my incremental cost of buying the new car? Anyone? So if I'm driving an old car and I am thinking now of replacing that car, what will my incremental cost be of... Exactly. So nothing, no rocket science here. The incremental cost will be how much I buy my new car for minus how much I sell my old car for. And what will my benefit be? The lower maintenance cost. Okay, that's the tangible benefit. The intangible benefits might be driving a new car, but mostly in this course we will focus on the tangible, quantifiable benefits. Okay, so do you think an analysis will be required there? Obviously, an analysis will be required where you need to look at what's the additional cost, what are the savings, and based on that, you can decide whether to do this replacement project or not. Okay, what about an expansion project? Okay, so expansion of existing products or markets. Here again, this requires a lot of analysis. When you expand, you need to understand what the growth will be. So as you notice over here, do you think finance people alone will be making decisions such as this, or will they be working with other functions? So you'll be working with other functions such as, once you've done, so actually, the obviously this whole analysis and forecasting, they are all intertwined. Yeah, they go hand in hand. So my larger point here is you need to work with marketing. Why do you need to work with operations or manufacturing? The productivity, the costs. Okay, so marketing and salespeople will help you figure out what the growth rate, what the revenue will be, what the top line, projected top line, the manufacturing or operations and inventory management people will help you figure out what the costs will be. The procurement team will help you figure out what raw material costs will be. And who is sitting in the middle of all this processing, getting all the input and processing the numbers? You know, that's the finance people are at the heart of all this activity. Okay, every function likes to think that they are at the heart of everything, but since this is a finance class, we will say that the finance function is at the heart. But the case, every function can also make a case why they are most important. The case that the finance function will make is, ultimately, if the salespeople say that we'll have a ton of growth, okay, is that sufficient in of itself to say this is a good project? Yeah, so ultimately, what projects do you do? Ultimately, what is the purpose of business? To make money, to maximize shareholder value. And who is the best judge of whether that's happening or not? Finance people. Okay, so that is the case for why finance is in the middle. Okay, just because you have a great product that everyone will buy, but if the cost of making that product is more than the cost of selling it, useless project. Okay, marketing people will be excited, but the finance people will tell them that, you know, you take a break, this is not making money, so we do not do this project. Okay. Actually, the people who progress most in their careers are those who have a decent marketing brain as well as a decent finance brain. Okay, so if you want to be at the top of a company at some point, try to have a good sense of marketing and a good sense of finance. Okay. Now, requiring explicit forecasts of growth in demand, you need to do a detailed analysis. And then the final decision is made after a, you know, typically made at a high level within a firm, which is hopefully where you will be eventually. Okay, what about expansion into completely new products? Here again, similar, lots of analysis required, and wherever there is analysis required, ultimately it will boil down to whether the numbers make sense, whether this is a profitable project or not in the long run. Okay, what about safety and environmental projects? For us in Pakistan, sometimes it might be a little hard to relate to this, but in most countries, in developed countries, there are regulations that need to be followed. In the US, for example, there are regulations such as OSHA, which stands for Organizational Safety, Health, etc. So there are regulations, for example, that when you are constructing a building, you have to wear hard hats. You have to have fire exits in your buildings. So all these are regulatory requirements. So if you are meeting one of those regulatory requirements, do you think you need to go do a detailed cost-benefit analysis? No, as in you have to do it. It's the law. Okay, so when you are just meeting regulatory requirements, then you have to do the job. Maybe there is some analysis. If there are two different ways of meeting the requirement, then you might figure out, as long as you are meeting the requirement, what is the more cost-effective way of doing so. So there might be a little bit of analysis, but generally not too much. Okay. What about R&D projects? What do we mean by R&D projects? Okay. So, So do you think a lot of detailed analysis happens there? But what is the challenge in that detailed analysis? No, that is true. You need to try and justify. Exactly. So that's a key point. So do you know that for large pharmaceutical companies, when they begin the research or development phase for a new drug, how many attempts do they make before they actually get to a drug which makes its way to the market? Yeah, there are thousands of... So when they start with these different molecules, they are starting with thousands of different molecules before they figure out which ones actually make it into a drug that will be approved and that people will buy. So obviously in R&D projects it is important to do analysis, but there is a lot of uncertainty and a lot of subjectivity. So how do you figure out cash flows? It's extremely hard. So we need to make, you know, use some tools such as decision tree analysis, which we will talk about later. And then there are long-term contracts where costs and revenues will accrue over many years. And what does DCF stand for? So discounted cash flow analysis will be used here. Okay, now some more terminology with regards to projects. Mutually exclusive projects. Have you heard this term in statistics?
Yes.
Okay, so if a project is taken on, the other must be rejected. So, any examples of a mutually exclusive project? Hassan? Okay, so, okay, I'm just saying in general.
Gas plant is against
petrol. Yeah, this is a great example. So, if you are buying a generator for IBA, for example, you need one large generator. Either you'll buy a gas generator or you will buy, say, a diesel generator. It doesn't make sense to buy both. Some of the other examples could be developed a little more, but this is a classic example. Okay, so here the question is whether Engro going into two possible lines of business. That actually is a decision that is constrained by a budget. Okay, that typically does not fall within this mutually exclusive. Mutually exclusive literally means that even if you have all the money in the world, it just makes sense to do one. That's the definition of mutually exclusive. Okay, so cash flows of a project can be, and typically, I think the definition we've done just now is good. The classic example that's used in your book is, if you need to transport goods within your factory, either you will put in a conveyor belt or you will buy a fleet of forklift trucks. It doesn't make sense to do both. Okay, and the gas generator versus diesel generator example is just as good. Okay, what are independent projects? As the term implies, these are projects where you can do multiple projects, and doing one project doesn't impact the decision on whether or not to do another project. Okay, now we are going to get into the meat of this chapter, which is talking about what are the different ways of figuring out what projects to do, what not to do. And we'll talk about six different methods: the payback method, discounted payback, NPV, IRR, modified IRR, and profitability index. And most of these methods, especially from 2 onwards, will rely on discounted cash flow, time value of money that we have talked about. Okay, so one last warning now. If I see anyone talking, you'll continue your conversation outside. Okay, so in the payback method, it's a very straightforward exercise where you are simply looking at how long it takes you to recoup your investment. Okay, let's take a simple example. Do you think this is a useful method? So you are saying, okay, I'm going to spend $10 million on a new plant. In how much time will I recoup that investment? Is it useful? Okay, so obviously, yeah, so that's, just as a general advice, life advice, when you look at something, first try to look at what's positive about it, and then pick holes, okay, as opposed to immediately picking holes. So most things in life, there is something good in there. Not everything is black and white, all good. There are some black and white things, but not everything is black and white, and payback method is also not black and white. So isn't it, when you invest something, it is useful to know in how much time I'll recoup my investment. If you want to know more stuff, definitely you want to know more stuff, but knowing how long it will take me to get my investment back is useful. Okay, so let's not discount this. Okay, so now here is an example. So how do you calculate payback? This you could have done after class 9 or 8 maths. You invest 100 and then you get 10, 60 and 80. That's your cash flow. What's the payback period? It's between 2 and 3 years. And I hope you can figure out why it's 2.4. Okay, what's your investment? That's the 100. By the end of 2 years, how much have you collected? So you have collected 70 over here. By the end of 3 years, how much have you collected? No, actually your cash coming in is 10 at the end of year 1, 60 at the end of year 2, and 80 at the end of year 3. So cumulative, how much cash have you collected? Okay, so where will 100 fall? So if you are to sort of create a even increase between 70 and 150, where would 100 fall? Actually, would 100 be closer to the 70 or closer to 150? This is year 2, this is year 3. So the 100, imagine that how much between 70 and 150 you have 80 more. So 80 over 1 year And how much more did you need? You only needed 30. So can you do your basic fractions here? So what will you do? 30 over 80 into the 1 year. So that is equal to 0.4, roughly. Okay, so all we are saying is it's sort of taking, you are prorating the number and figuring out that approximately your payback period is 2.4 years. We are actually going to use these projects later on also. In another project, you invest 100 and you get 70, and then 50 and 20. Okay, what's the payback period here? It's about 1.6. So purely from a payback analysis, which project is better? Yeah, so purely from a payback, this project S is better because you get your money back faster. Which project is more liquid? What does a liquid project mean? More liquid project means where you get your money back faster. Okay, so S is more liquid. Okay, now before I display the content of the slide, I just want you to tell me, what do you think is good, or what are the strengths of this method? No, right now just focus on the strengths. Okay, so yeah, actually it's giving you an estimate of how long. That's a good thing. Okay, any other benefit? What's less time consumed? Yeah, so the method is very easy. So it's easy, it quickly gives you a sense of how quickly you get your money back. So in other words, it tells you the liquidity of the project. Okay, so those are the two major strengths. So provides an indication. Why do we talk about, how does it give a sense for the risk? Okay, somebody. Exactly. So if the liquidity is high, which means you get your money back faster, that's lower risk. So that's an advantage. Easy to calculate and understand, as I think Hassan Shahir pointed out. Okay. What do you think now? Okay, so now that we have thought about the positives, now do you think this method has some weaknesses?
Doesn't incorporate the time value.
Exactly. It doesn't incorporate time value of money. Anything else? Rohan? Think. Vakar? So this, Sophia? Yeah. Next. What are you, like checking the answer on the iPad? Okay, so what are some of the weaknesses? Okay, maybe if you're paying attention, you might have an idea. Shahama? Okay, paying attention and still no idea. Next.
I think
it ignores
the cash flow periods.
It ignores?
The cash flow periods
in the
money.
So, okay, so we've identified that money that you are getting later is not being discounted. So that's an issue. Soha, any other weakness? A huge weakness. Next to Soha, name?
Sir, Eamon,
yeah.
Yeah, I thought that...
Okay, so let me just help you out here. Yeah, next. That's a minor. Next. Your name?
Saira.
It
doesn't take into account all the external factors.
The cash flows are based on the external factors. So, okay, let me just help you out here. This is so basic, and then you will kill yourself for this. So let's say you have two projects. Okay, in both cases you invest 100. Okay, so in project 1 you get 60 and 60 and the project ends. In project 2 you get 50, 50, 50 forever. According to the payback method, which project is better? So A tells you that you get your money back, so it's more liquid. But just looking at these two cash flows, which one would you rather go for?
B.
So the biggest problem is that the payback method ignores what happens after the payback. Okay, are you just concerned with your payback, or are you also concerned with the profit on top of the payback? Exactly. So you are concerned with payback, But then you are also concerned with what happens after the payback. You don't say, okay, I invested 100, I got it back, now I'm happy, I can go party. You still, you want that extra money so you can have a bigger party, right? So how much is that extra money? Okay, that's a huge... So which one do you think is a bigger problem? The one that I just said or time value of money? Yeah, exactly. So that is... Obviously, time value of money is also an issue. But what I just said is probably a larger issue. Okay, so ignores the time value of money and ignores the cash flow occurring after the payback period. So these are the main issues. In general, when you are talking strengths and weaknesses, it makes sense to talk about the major strengths and weaknesses. And the peripheral ones, if you talk about, that's extra credit. Okay. What about, so another method is called the discounted payback method. So, Turab, can you take a quick guess at what this means? Exactly. So, all we do with the, so will the, when we use the discounted payback method, do you think the payback period will be more than, equal to, or less than what you got with the previous method? It will always be more because future cash flows are being discounted. So all you do with this method is you take every future cash flow and you discount it back and you figure out how many years it takes for the discounted cash flow to exceed 100. So the procedure is fairly straightforward. What do you think? So this is our project. You invest 100 and then you get 10, 60, 80. What does this 9.09 mean? Yeah, this is the discounted value of 10. This is the discounted value of 60, and that's the discounted value of 80. So in this method, you get a discounted, or you get a payback period of 2.7. What was the period earlier without discounting? So without discounting, it was 2.4. Now that you use discounting, it becomes more. If we were to use a higher rate, here we are using 10%. If it's Pakistan and a risky project, the discount rate might be 20%. What would happen, Anusha, to the discounted payback period? There are three possibilities. Go up, go down, stay the same. So A is up, B is down, C is same. Sure? Okay, yeah, that's correct. The discounted payback period will go up because all these numbers will go down. Okay, so the payback period will go up. All right. Now, what about, so that was the, so how many methods have we talked about so far? So we have talked about the payback method. Before I just get to this, to check your understanding, what are the advantages of discounted payback? So what's the first one? Actually, you know, there is this psychological bias called anchoring. So just because we just talked about time value money and discounting, that's the first thing that comes out of your mouth. Okay, but if you take a step back and imagine that you were looking at this with a fresh perspective, what are the major advantages of discounted payback method? What's the first major advantage? Thumbs up. Am I asking you to compare the two methods? Of the discounted. So isn't an obvious strength that it's telling you the liquidity of the project? It's the same answer as before. It tells you how quickly you will recoup your money. Any other advantage? Yeah. Exactly. That's exactly. So just to put it in a structured way, the first advantage is that it tells you about the liquidity of a project, how quickly you will recoup your money. It's still relatively easy. Hopefully, you are at a stage now where discounting is not considered hard. So it's still relatively easy. An advantage over the earlier method is that future cash flows are discounted. So we do consider time value of money. Okay. What about a major disadvantage Serish.
After the payback.
Exactly. So a major disadvantage is that it doesn't take into advantage the cash flow after the payback is done. Okay, so basic stuff. What about the... Now, this is probably the most important method that you will learn, and the fundamentals of this you've already seen. I'm sure you might have seen this in earlier finance courses also. Net present value. How does this work? The first process is to estimate all the cash flows from your project. That includes all the outflows, the investment, typically which happens at the start of a project, but could also happen subsequently, and all the inflows. Okay, it addresses the riskiness of the cash flows. What this means is, if you are not certain, so you might make a projection like this, where you have at time zero, you invest 100, and then time one, time two, time three. So you are getting 10, and then 70, and then 80. When you are doing your analysis at time zero, are you sure that you will get this cash flow? No. So you need to assess what is the riskiness. So how sure are you, or how unsure are you? And just, I want to understand your intuition, see if you have an intuition to this. If this is a relatively risky project, then should you use a high discount rate? Cost of capital here, just think of this as the discount rate. If these are risky, then do you use a high rate? Yeah, so because when you use a higher rate, then the present value becomes less. Okay, so, and if you are pretty sure about these cash flows, then you can use a lower rate. And the logic is hopefully straightforward. The logic is that clearly if these are risky, then the present value of the risky cash flows should be less. Okay, so you discount it more. Okay, and just to make you remember this, if somebody is telling you something and that person in your mind is not very reliable, okay, what will you do? As in, you might actually use the expression that you're just discounting what he is saying, because you will, you know, if he says 10 things, of the 10 things, you might only, you know, believe 3. Okay, similarly, think of the cash flows of a risky project like an unreliable person telling you stuff. Okay, then the present value of that will be discounted heavily, and you will use a relatively small value here. Okay, if this is a low risk project, then you'll use a low discount rate, which means the present value is high. Okay, and then you simply find the NPV. So let's just do this. How many people find this sort of a formula straightforward? The summation sign. How many people are intimidated by this? Okay. So those who are intimidated by something like this need to realize that this is just a mathematical symbol. You can solve all these problems without even getting into this symbol, and I will show you how. Okay. If you have a project like this, okay, I'll tell you how I would want you to do something like this. Okay, the first thing, when you are doing a NPV analysis, I want you to always create a timeline. So on this particular project, you have at time zero an investment of 100. Then at time one, you have a cash coming in of 10, then cash coming in 60, and then cash coming in of 80. So all you need to do here is figure out the present value of all these cash flows. Earlier we talked about present value. Now we are talking about net present value. Does anybody know why there is this distinction? Exactly. So net means that when you calculate the NPV, you are netting out the initial outflow or initial investment. Okay, so, but effectively, you are just, what's the present value of minus 100? What's your name at the back?
Fawad.
So what's the present value of minus 100? This minus 100. It's minus 100. So that is the present value of the first cash flow. What's the present value of 10? assuming a discount rate of 10%. So it would be the present value of that 10 would be 10 over 1.1, which is this number. So you discount this back. What about the 60? You discount that back 2 periods and you get, so that would be 60 over 1.1 squared and you get 49. And similarly with 80, you discount that back, divided by 1.1 cubed and you get 60. Okay. And overall you get 18.79. So the NPV of this project is 19. Okay, I'm sorry. So the NPV of the project is 18.79. Okay, so what is the interpretation of this NPV? And this is critical. The interpretation is that the present value of the future cash flows is more in this particular project than the present value of your cost. Is that a good thing?
Yes.
What is the present value of your cost? The present value of your cost is 100. Okay, we are saying it's the cost, so we don't need to say it's negative. We know costs are negative. What is the present value of the cash flow that you are generating? Yeah, so the present value of the future cash flow is 118. So isn't it logical that if the present value of future cash flow is more than the cost, then it's a good project?
Yes.
You are generating value, you are creating value. Okay, so the NPV rule of whether you select a project or not is simply that if the NPV is positive, then the project is good. Okay, so that is fairly straightforward. So that is for project L. Now, for how many people are not fully comfortable with this? I want to make sure that you can do this. For project S, how would you come up with the NPV? So do you remember the cash flow for project S? Okay, so we had, let's just go back and look it up real fast. So for project L, we had 100, 70, 50 and 20. And initially you spend 100. So I want you to quickly come up and I want you to come up with the NPV of project S. Okay, so the answer, as you see, is 19.98. Okay, now don't distract, you know, that's the, just focus from now on. Okay, so 19, now if these were mutually exclusive projects, which one would you do? So if they are mutually exclusive, then you obviously do the one that has higher NPV. And if they are independent projects, then Saad. So then which one would you do? Yeah, exactly. So if they are independent, then both have a positive NPV and you do both. Okay. On a financial calculator, this is what you do. You just plug in to the cash flow register all the cash flows. You'd plug in the rate and it would give you the answer. Okay, so if you use this on an exam, I need to see these inputs. I just have noticed that people who understand the concept are better at using financial calculators. Those who think that they don't understand the concept and the financial calculator will save them, that typically does not happen. Okay, so make sure you understand the concept. Okay, so what is the rationale? I've already talked about this, that the present value of the inflows, if it's more than the cost, then you are generating value. And if you are asked what is the NPV rule, the NPV rule is that you do positive NPV projects if the projects are independent. What is the NPV rule if you have mutually exclusive projects? You do the one with the higher NPV. Okay. The next method is the internal. Actually, I just want to go back to one little point here. Do you understand now what this expression is? All this expression is saying is that it's the summation of the cash flows. So I'll just very briefly explain this to you, because I think you keep seeing it, so at some point you need to not be intimidated. So what were our cash flows for our simple for the project we just looked at? So times zero we had 100, and then 70, 50 and 20 at times 1, 2, 3. All this is saying is that you are summing up. So when t is equal to 0, you plug in cash flow 0, which is minus 100. What was k? That's the 10% over 1 plus 0.1 to the power of 0. So what is 1.1 to the power of 0? That is simply 1. Plus, then you make t equal to 1. So this becomes cash flow 1, which is 70 over 1.1 to the power of 1. And then t becomes 2. So then that becomes 50 over 1.1 squared. And then 20 over 1.1 cubed. The n simply refers to the number of periods over which you are getting cash flow. So if you understand this, great. If you don't understand it, you can still, all you are doing is taking every cash flow and coming up with the present value. So nothing intimidating about this, you know, just about the sigma. Okay. So next we'll talk about IRR. So IRR is the now you will see these seemingly complicated terminology and seemingly complicated formula, but the concept of IRR is very straightforward. So understand the concept first, and then we'll get into the details. The IRR of a project simply tells you what is the return that you are getting. So if you do a very simple project where you are investing, let's say you invest 100, and at the end of year one, you get 120. What is the return on this project? 20%. So 1 year later, you got back the 100 plus 20, so the return is 20. So you can say that the IRR is 20%. So you calculate the IRR based on the cash flows. Given cash flows, you are figuring out what is the return I am effectively getting. Let me give you another simple question. Let's say you invest 100, and then after 1 year you get 25, and then after 2 years you get 125. What's the IRR here? Next to Saad is name? Sameer. So Sameer, what's the IRR here? What's the return? If you invest 100 and 1 year later you get 25 and 2 years later you get 125, what's your return? Your annualized return. Everybody think about it. Write it down. I want to see how many people have this understanding. So what's your return? Just